there any other business anybody wants to bring up before we get into the agenda?
Can we talk about the farm afterwards?
I have that as the last item, so. Okay, so the first thing on the agenda is the vote on the town meeting warrant articles.
Okay, and to remind you, if you want to have written comments in the booklet itself about the budget, we need those next week. We're trying to go to print early. That was the whole point, or part of the point, having the budget process wrapped up early. So ideally, we'd like to go to print late next week, or maybe early the week after. I'll remind you with an email and copy Caitlin, who's the one we need to send it to. This is sort of tentative, but I've talked very briefly with the moderator. I think we're going to try to do the budget on the second night, which is sort of historically what we try to do. It's definitely not a one-night town meeting. It's up to you and whoever the chair or the selectman is to decide whether you want to also delay your remarks to the same night as the budget. I don't know, but that's just one option. The first article for you to consider tonight for voting is four. That's in your handout on page 5. We're here to answer any questions. I'll go over the enterprise funds a little more because the general fund budget was amended at November town meeting, which is why there's so little changes here. The only thing since November in the general fund are effectively a small change in school technology, just for clarification. The building security, instead of doing it as a generic thing, we're going to do specifically the dispatch center as the first part of that project, if you will. And the fire engine needed to be replaced 1 year sooner than we had it planned, so we had to move a couple things around for that.
So for clarification, because I was a little confused with the FY19, so the dispatch center, that is part one of two, basically?
I wouldn't say it's part one of the building security project, if you will.
Okay, because I was, then the next one talked about two-part project, and I never heard, okay.
Yeah, there's kind of two parts that we did in executive session that did not include this. This was just something we needed to do at some point, and it seemed like it was better to do it at the beginning of the project.
Oh, so then there will be two additional.
Yes. All right. It's a total of $4 million. Could be in any number of parts, but it was described to us as a sort of highest priority and then other.
Okay. No, because I'd like to see us starting to address that.
Okay. I'll spend a little more time with the enterprise funds. At November town meeting, we described and discussed the downtown infrastructure issue. However, since we did not amend the enterprise fund budgets, we now have to do that. It's already been done in the general fund. So again, as a guess, $100,000 each general fund and the three enterprise funds. We don't know what we'll learn, although you'll see something a little bit later. In order to make room for that in water, a truck was moved out 1 year, and you can see some of the changes. Sewer, pretty much the same thing, the infrastructure assessment, and then moving one item of capital out. Stormwater, I'm going to spend a little more time on shortly. The selectmen next Tuesday are going to vote on rates for water, sewer, and stormwater. There is a reasonably important project that's been in the capital plan for a while at Sturgis Park that's on the menu for next year. So this is all debt, all debt items you've seen before, capital items you've seen before. This is in the capital plan that was a part of the budget. I don't know if there's any questions. Let me just keep going through all the articles. Do you want to stop and vote and assign?
Yeah, I think if anybody has any questions, we'll certainly stop for those, but then we can just vote them all at the end, I guess.
Okay. That's good. Page 7. Do you guys have one of these? It's probably extras.
Yep.
There's a lot of moving around, but if you go to the end, it's not the use of free cash. I'm going to spend a little extra time on health insurance. I wrote down just because I wanted to read off, and this is not what the premiums cost. This is the net change of cost to the town. So, for instance, if premiums were up 2% and there was 1% more people, enrollment went up, it's 3%. So this is the dollars. And I'm going to read the numbers, and you're going to be surprised. 2009, up 2.3%. 2010, down 13.2%. 2011, up 10.8%. 2012, up 3.3%. 2013, negative 0.2%. 2014, 3.9%. And then it starts getting a little higher. 2015, 7%. 16, 8%. 17, 6.9%. And so far, the run rate this year is about 3.5%. The 9 years other than the current year is 2.9% annualized. That's pretty good.
It's incredible.
And again, you're saying that's the combination.
This is the actual dollars that have gone out of the general fund for health insurance premiums. So it includes premium changes plus plus or minus enrollment if it went up or down. Typically, it has gone up. So I understand that health insurance generically is kind of a lightning rod out there. You know, we have a really good relationship with our unions, and they're doing some work again this year in two parts. One, we hope to have an announcement in April, and one probably in June that'll, you know, certainly live within the budget for next year, but could take a serious bite out of the so-called budget gap each year by making some more changes. So, you know, they're a really good group. They totally get it. We do have $175,000 surplus this year because we did not see enrollment. We've also offered an opt-out plan where employees get paid about 25% of what it would have cost, and we save about 75%, and that's been more successful than I would have ever thought.
How'd you get to annualized 2.9? That seems
all those numbers I said put together.
I know, it does sound shocking.
From a CAGR, if you do the CAGR.
The minus 13, and you know, there's a lot of low numbers.
Minus what?
13%.
Oh, we had the minus 13 1 year?
Which year
was that?
We went, that was 2010. We went to a tiered program.
So oh, okay.
What happened was quite a lot of dollars went out of the employees' pockets from then on.
Okay.
Copays and everything else.
I guess
way
that
up.
Does. Maybe that's it.
Yeah.
Okay.
We don't usually do this, but we had some surplus capital available, you can see, so you know, we're certainly no need for that. There's a lot of moving parts in vocational education, but not a big change. John and I have a hard time getting information on this.
Yeah,
book schools.
It's too late.
They tell us the enrollment around February.
It's a while to take attendance, I guess.
Is that maths?
Maths.
Okay.
Really hard.
Property casualty was higher than we thought. It had to do with allocation between general fund and enterprise funds, and it's not a big deal for this year, but it is maybe a problem for next year. We might have budgeted $25,000 too low. There's been some vacant positions. I've asterisked some because of, you'll see later, economic development. Our director's in California spearfishing. He says hello. Public service expenses, you know, what's going on next door, is a 40B. 40Bs, the developer pays all the costs associated with peer review to defend, for the town to defend. For 40Rs, they don't. We can ask them, but they're not required to. So this $25,000 is for one, maybe two, of the several 40Rs, there's four I can think of, so that we can hire consultants to study things like traffic and so on and so forth, and defend the abutters or whatever. You're going to see more of that in the next couple of years. There's 16 projects going on right now.
Well,
we're
just talking about that. Could we get a list of what those projects are? It's so hard to keep straight.
If you look at when the town meeting warrant report comes out, mm-hmm. Well, actually in here, there's a list of maybe six or seven of them,
okay.
The bigger ones.
Right.
And then there's a bunch of little subdivisions, three, four, five houses that are technically projects,
mm-hmm.
but the biggest ones will be captioned. Sharon needs some money for an overlap. We changed treasurers, and actually the old treasurer's still coming in on weekends. I'm going to leave the public safety overtime just for last, so I'll talk a little more about that. There's a slight savings in public safety expenses, as you can see. Another vacancy, we're having an impossible time hiring an engineer. Two people have accepted the job and then changed their mind. Small request for mowers. Snow and ice, we have no idea. Today helped. I'm just going to skip ahead to the end here and come back to public safety. If you go to page 10, the net of all this is a $52,500 savings. But we've proposed to reduce the use of the inspections revolving fund by that same amount. because it's not paying for the economic development director and what he, what might have been his or her expenses. So there's no, this balance is exactly, honestly, I added more money into public safety overtime to make the balance exactly. There's no need for free cash. The only real variable that could happen between now and town meeting, I suppose it could be public safety overtime, but certainly snow and ice. So this, you know, probably will be amended on the floor of town meeting. Quickly, you can see in the enterprise funds, MWRA assessment, that's the actual purchase of water or sewer services, was higher in sewer and lower in water. We don't take credit in water because we don't need it to spend anywhere, but we do need to fund the sewer one because we may not have enough surplus funds. And then drainage work, that's related to at least the post office project.
Yeah.
Our engineers have been out there. The number is a plug figure. They will know in the next 3 weeks whether or not they've hit ledge. They've done test boring. So that's definitely a worst case number. It could be much smaller. But that's money they're going to need to do to connect the drainage system in the street to the project itself. And again.
And that comes out of PAR?
This comes out of the stormwater revolving fund. There's $900,000 in reserve, so it's not really a big issue. It's an issue you can negotiate with a developer, but this is not something that any of us foresaw, so we didn't negotiate it, and it's, again, probably going to be a relatively small number.
Mm. Is that sewer expense, is that a problem going forward, too? Just like a one-time adjustment?
It was accounted for in the budget next year already, but yes, it would be.
Yeah.
It would be expected to be. To go back now to public safety, both chiefs are here. I'll first give you a little background. It's kind of like the annual March discussion. Mm-hmm. I got a lot of payroll data, I don't know, maybe a month ago when I first learned of this. And just this morning, I got some good HR data on hours. So I've been able to look at this much more analytically detailed than we've looked at it in the past to try to understand it. I've had to ask the question legally whether I can share the information I have with the chiefs because it's about each other's employee, so I don't know the answer yet, so we haven't had a real good discussion yet, but it's pretty interesting. You know, Greg has a memo in here that explains from his perspective, and I don't disagree with that. The real issue is when employees are missing from work for whatever reason all at once. You can have the same amount of injuries spread out. It can be no cause of overtime at all. When, especially the first three injuries on page 9 happened, all overlapped, and they all happened during the summer when there's heavy vacations. So I've looked at the fire budget since October, the end of October, and the overtime run rate is not bad at all. It all happened in the first 4 months. I shouldn't say all, but most of it happened in the first 4 months. I guess the problem or the challenge is we need a better financial model so we can know that more precisely as things happen. And that's what I'd like to build towards. We do that in health insurance. I have a really good idea of exactly what's going on. We just don't have a lot of sophisticated financial tools. We'll just basically need to build them.
I know, I'm almost surprised there aren't sort of contract groups out there. Because these long-term injuries, you know they're going to be out. So to get that contract firefighter, and I'm almost surprised there's not some that cover a whole region, because this isn't just a unique challenge to us.
Yeah, I remember, Greg, you certainly chime in, but you've spoken to FinCom in the past about how you can't really even share someone with North Reading or anyone because the policies and procedures are so different, one fire department
to
the next.
You have different equipment. You also have a union in civil service, so there's other things to consider. But yeah, you couldn't bring somebody from North Reading and put them up in the seat of the cab with one of our fire trucks and expect them to drive it effectively. You know, you have to go through a training program, so it's difficult to do. You know, one of the things we try to do is increase the number of personnel that we have so we have a cushion when we get into this position. When you look at the summertime, we were down four positions in July, but five positions in August. Every time that somebody was out, we're just hiring continually. On one of our four groups, it was below the minimum, so we were hiring just to get to the minimum. That's if everybody was in, and that's during the peak vacation period. And when you look at the overtime run usage, you see it kind of goes along with like the school calendar, because a lot of us have children in the school, so we take vacation when school is up. So I can see peaks in vacation during the summertime, during school vacations. During school vacations, major holidays and things like that. You see increased usage. This time of the year, it's lower. And we also had two vacancies. We had a retirement that was planned in March, and then we had a retirement in June that was not planned. We hired the replacement people, had them identified in August, but we couldn't get them into the fire academy until January. So we were short those positions throughout the year. So that, with the three injuries and those two other vacancies, just put us down at the minimum level. So it's just you pay overtime on vacations continually, where if we were fully staffed, you would not.
I should have looked. I don't remember the exact numbers, but when we eliminated a position in fire and police, I remember fire more so. Maybe we saved $80,000 on the salary, but we also increased overtime by like $35,000, knowing that there was going to be some correlation. And that was probably whatever the number was like that. It was a good guess, because one more person would not have solved this problem unless they could work 24 hours a day for several days in a row, because the problem was five positions all at once. In the first 3 or 4 months.
Yeah, positions, sorry to interrupt, but it hit every group. It wasn't like there was one person out where one person filled that vacancy. It hit every group that we had.
Right, so would you say you were virtually, during those summer months, you were calling someone in for overtime
every shift? Every shift.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And sometimes more than one every mm-hmm. shift. The group that was down to nine, probably we would be hiring multiple times for that because of vacations.
Greg, in the scheme where the override passes and the four additional firefighters come in, I assume that should help mitigate this kind of
yes.
thing, because you'll have a little
We would
little
have
cushion.
A two-person cushion. We allow two people to be on vacation, and so fully staffed, two people on vacation, we wouldn't be hiring at all,
right.
Unless somebody was sick or injured.
And once, I sort of learned about this, the town crossed out, I think, the last three items on its override list, if you will, and just put overtime into fire. It's like, this has really got to go.
Yeah.
So it's a vexing problem. I like math, so I enjoy working on it. There's no easy answer. You almost need a public safety reserve fund that can help smooth out the ebb and flow. And then, broadly, I would just keep the discussion broadly. Both departments have been very busy. Reading is not a dull place. And, a given incident, I sort of feel like, the show is over and everyone's leaving.
Tip your waiters and waitresses.
Try the veal. A weekend of overtime can easily cost each department $25,000. That's $50,000. What I will enjoy doing in the next few months is trying to really get into overtime, analysis, and try to understand, because some of it's seasonal based on vacation, some of it's unpredictable based on injuries, but more of it is something we should have a better handle on in any given pay period than we do. Shouldn't be looking back and saying, oh, yeah, look at that. I mean, Greg knew, but I didn't know. And we didn't have real good data. So, I'm starting to think, and I didn't think this a year ago, that four extra firefighters, I would have said a year ago, one and a fraction of them will pay for itself with overtime. It might be more now. I just don't know. If firefighters, knock on wood, continue to get injured, it's going to be more helpful to have more firefighters.
Have you talked to other towns
The last time I did, our fire budget was about average in terms of overtime divided by wages. And our police is a little below average for funding and for need. So it's not that Reading is, you know, horribly different. It's just a profession that has this. You know, they have to be in tip-top condition to come to work. I can come to work in any condition, they can't, so.
What's interesting about these ones,
and come take this one, actually.
Sorry.
Of the three injuries, two of them were medically related. Mm-hmm. They weren't related to the job.
That's true.
The second one, the four, two of them were not related to the job. Two of them were related to the job. It's been a long day.
Not a headache. No.
Yeah.
No, not a headache.
And from what I've looked at, one never knows what might happen. What I've looked at, this should give a cushion to each department to not need to talk to the chair if nothing unusual happens. There should be money turned back, as is typically the case.
I look back 1 year, the fiscal 17 actual, I think, turns out to be about what fiscal 18 budget plus that 180.
Yeah, and the fiscal 17, I'm doing it from memory, when we sat here a year ago, was the first year in the last three or four in which had actually gone over the original budget.
Right.
We had a transfer, but we didn't end up using it. But that was the first time it was over. This will be the second time in a row it's over, so it's not a one-time phenomenon anymore, and thus mm-hmm. deserves a lot more attention. That's the end of Article 5.
I have a couple more questions on the buybacks, the sick and vacation buybacks. We always ask this question about, geez, are these kind of whittling down?
Yeah, definitely. And also, it's lumped together, but you know, some of that's vacation, and that won't whittle away. That's a real thing. I'd actually say, as a fraction of both of those, much more is vacation than sick suck.
Okay, good. And one other question, the animal control,
mm-hmm.
That's a big bump, right? Minus 50?
Yeah, we had it funded at 50 and we haven't regionalized, so we've kept the same employee and had to pay him wages instead of expenses.
Okay.
I have shaken the hand of an area town administrator to regionalize soon, so we'll see how that works out. I may have shaken my hand.
Thank you.
Article 6, we don't know of any prior year bills, so we'll skip that.
I'm sorry, one last question.
Oops, sorry.
The B91, the benefits, wages.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, I forgot that. It's tucked up there. I don't honestly remember as either a police officer or a firefighter that was injured on duty and unable to work and in the retirement process, and they have since retired. So if you will, that's what Sharon described a few years ago. That's a wage that's unproductive to the department. It's like a benefit. They could have retired earlier. It's just the retirement board, and that includes locally and Boston, didn't act as quickly as they might. So if they're not being useful to the department, it's really sort of in an accounting sense not fair to charge the department.
Right, so we made that change a couple years ago put it under here.
Yeah, so
occasionally
that's
basically
that's
out on injury pre-retirement and then deciding to retire. So let me take it out of here.
It's when, between the department head and the town accountant, they agree that, and she's on the retirement board, a retirement is at least 99% or more likely because of the medical condition of the person.
Mm-hmm.
There's always that possible chance you don't know.
Right, but these are the wages we paid while they were out previous to.
Correct. And had they retired right away, they would have been receiving a pension instead, so that's why it's kind of like a benefit. Article 7 is only public works equipment, nothing too interesting. Let's see.
Well, we don't usually get rid of 2011 trucks, I was surprised.
Yeah, I didn't ask them about that. I'll have to ask.
That Eager Beaver is only worth $500? I'm kidding.
What'd you say?
There's a 1989 Morbark Eager Beaver. for $500.
Did you say you'd pay $500? I went once. I thought I heard that.
He can't.
It must be wood.
Conflict.
Yes. It's a woodchuck or something.
Yeah, a woodchuck. That'd be called a woodchuck in that case.
It sounds like it belongs on your road.
Load them up.
Article 8 is the annual OPEB. We're not suggesting any change to what was already budgeted in terms of moving that into the fund itself.
And again, this is a two-step process where
we first have town meeting appropriate a number, and then it's a protection against health insurance during the year.
Yeah.
And I have to say it hasn't ever been used, although when that thing was created, it looked like it would be needed.
Right, still a good setting.
It's not a bad strategy, yeah.
Where's the trust fund on that, on the OPEB? Is that, where's the trust fund? Is that still in limbo? Setting
it's
up?
No.
Well, we had to
town meeting
that
approved
time.
It.
Yeah. Yeah. We haven't done it yet with the
investing
of it.
Because RMLD wants to get in on that too.
See, Article 9. This is a slightly different process because of state law changed a couple of years ago in revolving funds. Town meeting has previously, and it's somewhere in the write-up, added projects to the inspections revolving fund, and just to be clear, these are one-time revenues coming in from the project, you know, building inspector, whatever. And the suggestion is to consider adding all these projects. These are the ones that are active. These are just the bigger ones: Schoolhouse Commons, Reading Village, Postmark Square. The Mark Building doesn't have a name yet, so it's called 20 or 24 Gould Street. 467 Main is the Sunoco station on Main Street. The theory being that one-time revenues from this can absorb one-time costs related to the project, such as hiring, you know, peer consultants to, you know, protect the neighborhood, if you will. We don't really have a good project. We have a good projection on what new growth will yield from this. It's conservatively $1 million for more than just as shown, but the other projects we know about, which is good. I don't have a real good number. We've talked about an estimate for how much permit fees. It's too hard to know. It's too early for some of these. It will be certainly more than $100,000 total. And again, town meeting is the only appropriating an authority to spend money. Actually, they give me the annual authority to do it. Historically, it's been used for a variety of things. Since I've been town manager, it's narrowed a little. But it could be used to fund capital projects. So, for instance, the infrastructure thing I told you about, you know, if we decide that the general fund can't really absorb a capital cost that's necessary, we, you know, you could tap on this fund as a one-time resource.
And do you sometimes hire contractors to do some of the permitting work just because of the workload?
We haven't so far.
But that's an option.
Once upon a time, we had an assistant building inspector full-time that was paid out of this fund for a couple of years, maybe 3 years. We now have three part-time building inspectors, all that used to be leading building inspectors in their community in the budget. If you don't recall, we have a full-time building inspector and a cut to their hours proposed, with or without an override, with an override, more hours. So I think we're okay in building inspector costs, but we are using some offset, 40 or 50 grand for that. Mm-hmm. If this activity were not, you know, viewed in the next couple of years, we wouldn't need as many hours, and we wouldn't need this fund to pay for that share of the hours. We'd still need a full-time building inspector. It's, you know, the building right now, because construction is so strong in the area, it's difficult to hire good qualified inspectors because they're busy doing construction. We have good ones, but I just talked to another nearby community today. It's having a hard time. I wanted to borrow some of ours, for instance. So. Next is Amy's request at the library to broaden the purpose of a revolving fund. I don't know if FinCom wants to take a vote on that. It is or it isn't a financial issue. It's certainly not a large fund. But they want to add fees. They now collect some fees, and they want it to be able to go into this fund. And again, the dollar value is quite small. Article 11 is the more traditional revolving fund article. And the only thing this does now, because of the change in state law, is that column that says expenditure limits. So although I've added in revenue source on page 16 for the inspection revolving fund, that's just basically legally a footnote. The actual purpose of this article is to set expenditure limits.
And that's done annually, right?
Right. And I should add, and I don't know if it doesn't really matter to you, but back on the on page 12, we have a bylaw. This is it. The bylaw never listed specific projects in it. Ray's suggestion was to list them because this article that's done annually is no longer a legal binding article listing projects. So this is one of the things I told you was an improvement by the state that's actually worse, one of the few. They've split our annual inspection revolving fund process into two parts sometimes. If we do nothing else but just change the expenditure limits, one article's good. If we do anything else, we have to have two articles. One changes the bylaw, and then one sets the expenditure limits not in the bylaw. So it's just one of those things. And you can see on 17 a write-up for all the balances if you're interested in some of the revolving funds. Some of them are small, some of them are large. Certainly the inspection thing is large. The rest are pretty small. The town forest one is still empty. Yeah. Article 12 is the annual affordable housing trust fund. It's again sort of just a simple formula. It's updated for the balance. It's not much different than it was a year ago. There's been no activity in the fund other than interest being earned. You know, the town would like to find a way to grow that fund, especially with annual revenue somehow, but we haven't figured out a way. And Article 13 is school request to extend the ability to do a contract longer than 3 years, which is the typical limit out to 6 years. I'll let them describe it, but obviously if people have a three-year limit, that's not economically advantageous. But if you get permission to go beyond it, it is.
This is specifically for digital curriculum. So recent trends is they're moving away, much to my dismay, from hard copy. So it's all now digital, and what we've seen over the last couple of cycles is that we're able to get better pricing if we're able to go out 5 to 6 years versus 3 years. So we would like the flexibility based upon the curriculum and the pricing and the way the contracts are structured to go out to the 6 years.
It just gives you the flexibility. You might find, oh no.
We may find that 3 years is a better pricing deal when you average it out over the life of it, depending what the terms are, what the actual is. But when we were working on this last year for the new science curriculum, we did discover that had we been able to go out longer, the pricing would have been far more advantageous. And we know that that's the way things are going, and with a lot more new curriculum coming out, this would afford us more flexibility.
And we tend to use things for more than 3 or 4 years.
What this affords us, because it's digital, is you get the updates.
You get the updates.
More frequently,
updates.
Whereas
with
the books, you, and my science book was
broken. It's not stagnant.
Whereas hard copy is
awesome.
Stagnant, whereas these, the updates come out continuously throughout.
Right. You get the updates over the contract term.
Does FinCom usually vote on stuff like this? Like, this doesn't feel like a FinCom thing.
I don't remember, but I don't think so. But I was remembering we did a rubbish contract for 10 years, and I remember describing it to you. I should have looked. I don't remember if you voted. I would say probably no.
Yeah, probably. Like, I can see if there was a contract where, like, a dollar amount, like, if you were at that. I don't know. Otherwise,
well, you know, it is
like
a financial issue, and that you're committing money for a period of time.
Contract's
going
to be different.
Right, but you would,
difficult is if we did, we would only be able to bring it forth in November and April, and to try to tie all of our renewals to only after November or only after April gets a little bit tough. So we don't have a contract right now. We just know coming up towards the end of this year, we do have some up.
We're trying to be proactive.
Okay.
Yeah. Do these get managed? Not managed. How do students access them? Do you have to access them?
They get a code.
Digital? Okay, and it's digital only. We're not
it's all yes, yes,
stuff.
It's digital only.
Great.
Sometimes we do get a classroom set hard copy, but it's digital only.
Do the students use their own devices, or
we do have carts
Yeah.
They don't get their own device. I wish they did.
Bring your own.
They can bring their own device,
yeah.
Yes, depending
okay.
on the level. We do it at middle school, we do it at high school. But we have carts of laptops.
And that's why as part of the science curriculum last year, you saw it was a combination of the digital curriculum and the carts to be able
right.
to utilize them.
Didn't we vote at one point for to get DPW able to get to the 10-year contracts?
Yeah, that was the rubbish contract
yeah.
2 or 3 years ago, and that's been, I don't even want to jinx it, it's just been phenomenally good.
Yeah. Yeah.
One of the area vendors went out of business, exited the municipal sector with 1 week's notice, you can imagine, and that sort of moved prices up, shall we say. So we got a 3% escalator a year for 10 years, we're thrilled.
Yep.
The recycling market has collapsed, China's not buying stuff anymore. So there's a possibility our contract might be broken, you know, and they understand legally what it's going to cost them, but that's how good of a deal we have is now we're concerned it's such a good deal. The vendor is going out of the towns and asking for $100,000 a year, so just so you know. But yeah, contracts can be very advantageous when you lock in an affordable rate. You're taking a chance, maybe it'll go down, but you get certainty, which for us is really beneficial thing.
Are you going to vote on this? I'm only
yeah.
asking this because I think it is a financial matter, and if a town meeting, if for some reason...
No, I'm with you. No, absolutely. I brought it up, and then everyone explained
okay.
why it's okay.
last article that you'd care about is the budget you've already voted, so that's it. So if, while you vote, you would also assign reports, take notes.
Sorry, did you do 16 or anything?
Oh, sorry, that's chapter 9. Yeah, I just got an estimate. It's like 596,000. It's been right around 600,000 for most years. And the reason that's in there is because we technically authorize debt, but then we just get the cash and never actually issue debt.
But yeah, the article's worded kind of in a strange way. It's authorizing us to do something we don't actually, the town doesn't actually intend to do, but does it have to be worded that way?
It does, and you know, for instance, if the legislature were slow to release funds, we could borrow with this authorization in order to do projects we might have bid out. So it sort of makes sense in
okay.
a protective scenario, but
okay.
some years the legislature has done an early, whatever you call them, so not the state aid thing, but they've released Chapter 90 in April.
Mm-hmm.
So, that's it. It's a good, solid 2 nights of town meeting, potentially 3.
Okay, so the first one you have to vote on is Article 4, right?
Yep.
Okay, I have a motion.
Second.
And any questions or comments? No? All in favor?
And I can take this one if you want.
7 of us, sure. Article 5. Vote on the operating budget changes for 2017?
18.
Oh, sorry.
So moved.
Okay, second?
Second.
Oh, okay. Any questions or comments? All those in favor? Opposed? 7-0. And who wants to take this one? Anne?
Sure.
Do it the same way we did the last vote.
Oh, yeah. Brandon, you're going to get the next one. Good thing it's tabled. You can skip 6.
Make a motion to accept Article 7 as written.
Okay.
Second.
Questions or comments? All those in favor? 7-0. Mark,
I'll
I think you're
it.
Up on this one?
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Article 8.
Motion to approve Article 8 as written.
Second.
Okay. Any questions or comments? All those in favor? 7-0.
And I'll take that.
Okay. And
motion to accept Article 9 is written.
Second.
Okay. Questions or comments? All those in favor? David?
Yep.
Didn't know whether you wanted to abstain or object. And
sorry, I was just wanting, did we jump over 8?
No.
No,
we jumped over 6.
Jumped 6, yeah.
Oh, jumped over 6.
Okay, and Eric, I think you're up for 9.
I'm actually going to be traveling, so I won't be able to make town meeting. Oh. And I don't trust Mark Mold adequately.
That's it. I'm very happy about that.
I'll take that.
Okay.
You muted yourself.
That's right.
Just want to make sure that was 9.
Yep. Yes, it was 9.
Okay.
Did we want to vote on 10?
Certainly no harm.
Yeah, there's no harm. Yeah, I think so. Since we're going to vote revolving funds anyway.
Right.
Yeah.
I'll make a motion to accept Article 10 as written then.
Second. And any questions? Comments? No. All those in favor? Okay, 7-0. And we'll assign this one to Paul. How's that?
There you go.
And Article 11.
Motion to approve Article 11 as written.
Okay.
Second.
Okay. Any questions? Comments? No? Okay. All those in favor? 7-0. And I guess Vanessa can have this one. And next is Article 12.
Make a motion to accept Article 12 as written.
Second.
Okay. Questions? Comments? All those in favor? And go back to you, Paula, because I think we're going to be done before Vanessa gets here. So. Mm-hmm. Okay, so Article 13 was the contract one, and we were going to vote on that. So I have a motion to accept Article 13.
You'd like a motion? I move to accept Article 13 as drafted.
Okay.
Second.
Okay. Any additional questions? All those in favor? Anne, sorry.
Motion to accept Article 16 as written.
Second.
Okay, any questions or comments on Article 16? All those in favor? 7-0. And Mark, you're up for this one?
You got it.
Article 17.
Motion to accept Article 17 as written.
Okay.
I want to do the report, Peter.
Yeah, that's fine. Okay.
So if you're all set, thanks.
All right. And then next item is the approval of the meeting minutes.
Do you want to move for the proposed meeting just so the school people can?
Oh, okay. Well, I did have a question. That's on a comment. John, I don't think you meant, or I don't think you said 15 years. As if, it says, you explained the school budget has not been sustainable for the past 5 years and below the level service for those years as well. However, the override budget does have some sustainability built in. It won't last. And it says 15 years. I don't think you.
Well, that would be the last override.
That was the last override, yeah.
Oh, okay. Okay, so that was from, okay. All right.
you know how to respond to typo.
Thank you.
It's always better with the same person. Motion, same second.
Copy paste and all of that.
Good, good.
All right, so on the meeting on the 28th, I don't know how many of you found time to watch the Board of Selectmen's meeting last week. There was a lot of discussion about the meeting on the 28th, and I think the current proposal is that it be in the format of a financial forum, and there was an issue raised by town council that we couldn't hold it on in a public building. So we need to find another venue, and I think currently there are two possibilities. One was RCTV, and the other was the Unitarian Universalist Church. Is RCTV independent? I sent that back to you, but I...
So they're a 501c3 organization, right? So I think they are. They're
I'll ask. That's probably fine. Right. You know, it's one of those optics questions, probably more than a legal question. I don't see a problem. But.
Yeah. Okay.
So if that's okay, I did speak with Phil Rushworth today.
What kind of space do they have? Sort of big, if you will, kitchen room?
So the other room, I guess, will hold 70 to 80 people, the studio. And then we could also use the kitchen if we needed, in addition, and could get, I think, a total of about 150 or so. Let me check my... Oh, sorry. Wrong. Got to take it on Gmail.
Does that sound like enough people there, Rick?
That's a lot of people for that.
We asked what the legal limit was. That was a number that was quoted back to me.
Standing.
So it's a function of setting up chairs. Mm-hmm. So not round tables, and but it would be very organized as chairs, and that's the way that they suggested doing it.
What's the Unitarian Church like? I've been in it, but it's been a while, and I've never seen a setup, really.
I would say the last meeting I went there is probably like a 100 seating capacity, and then there are probably another 30 or 40
right,
standing.
Would you say it's sort of like four of these rooms, but similar scale
yeah.
in terms
yeah,
of
yeah,
length?
Yeah, I would say
it's
accurate.
Yeah. I would have said it was even a little bigger than four.
Maybe a little bigger.
Yeah, I think it's north of double the length and then the same.
Yeah.
It was expensive.
One of the questions is what kind of RCTV coverage do you want, and what are the options of the two locations?
Yeah.
Assume an RCTV is fine.
So I explored this a little bit.
Okay.
So I asked if it could be covered live, and the answer is at RCTV studio, definitely yes. At another venue, maybe. And so Phil's going to have to check. He's not sure if it's possible or not. But he said if it's not possible live, he could certainly have it for the next day. But that kind of may have missed one of the elements we're looking for.
Okay.
I think the RCTV space would probably be better if we think it's big enough.
And the price is better too.
Yeah, it was offered at no charge.
Yeah.
I'm looking for the exact numbers, but I believe 150 or so was the total, maybe a little bit more.
And the kitchen.
So hang on.
Say that again.
What is the agenda going to be? I know we have a school committee meeting before that meeting, so.
For the most part, it's just going to be open questions, I think, and we're going to try. I don't know what you were referring to on the service mark, but we're going to try and solicit questions ahead of time.
Yeah, so there are a couple things mentioned. The focus was to be able to answer for the community any questions that they have about the upcoming override, to have all of the elected and FinCom together for that, and to solicit questions in advance as well as in person, and then maybe even the possibility of getting questions live coming in using a little bit of technology called Slido, just to get some questions coming in, which is essentially a texting that would come in so that we're in a position to answer whatever questions people have.
And not in a
that would be challenging.
And is the idea not to have it in a public building in case something
legal.
Gets close to advocacy?
Yeah.
You can't, if it was part of a scheduled meeting, you can discuss the override, but you can't specifically schedule a meeting for the override because that's using public resources. It's a bit of a fine line.
Excuse me, the answer is the studio holds 100 with rows of chairs. The screening room holds 60. So it would be a total of 160 if we needed both. They're both available. The studio would be the room to start with, though.
That's the way to go.
Just to give you an example, town council did a pretty thorough job, but if you didn't see it, tomorrow there's a, weather permitting, there's a lunch at the senior center that I'm supposed to speak at. I can't make a presentation because there's a ballot question now, but I can answer questions. And it's during my work day, but that's okay if I only answer questions. It's a lot of, and it's a public building. There's a lot of intricacies. And it's, honestly, you know, the gray area is large. You could do some of the things that Ray is cautioning against. There's, frankly, people in the community that are looking at every detail of things we do and file an open meeting law complaint, so we're just trying to be real careful. Mm-hmm. The selectmen wanted to come to the senior center lunch, and they decided they shouldn't because there might be some question that they shouldn't be there, which is a shame.
As in no one or
no
as a group?
One.
No one.
No one. Wow. So it's just unfortunate. Again, if you were having, like, tonight, you could now spend an hour and do a question and answer session because you've already had a posted meeting for another purpose. But you can't just call a meeting for that one purpose, and we all assume that would be the one purpose. Town employees cannot, in addition to not using town resources, we can't participate during the workday with very few exceptions. I'm one of the few exceptions. Gee, thanks. the deputy chiefs and the fire chief have been asked to do something with a video, and they have to do it off duty after hours because they are, you know, employees during the day. They can't duck out for half an hour, technically. I mean, so we're just trying to be super careful because you just don't want any small thing to blow
sure.
up.
And the interest of being super careful, is there going to be an issue with us? We still need to post it.
Yes.
We're all going to meet together.
Yes, you still have to meet in a location that's publicly accessible, so you can't go
okay.
meet in someone's living room.
Mm-hmm.
And absolutely all the boards will be posted at whatever location.
Okay.
Yes, and there will be minutes.
Okay.
It just isn't using a public building,
okay.
which is a taxpayer resource.
Can I just ask, are we still chipping in then for RCTV? There was
no charge if we use RCTV.
Oh.
I caution you about sending agendas back and forth to workers among elected officials, you know, off duty. You can do what you want. But just be real careful about this topic, unfortunately.
Yeah.
I'm going to have to pick up the phone and call me if you really need something. That's fine. But, you know, I can't get involved really in planning and the logistics. We'll help as we can. Just, again, I just want to be super cautious.
Mm-hmm.
The rules changed once there became a ballot question legally.
Mm-hmm.
And someone asked me this, well, how come last override you can go out and do all these things? Well, we did them in the summer well before there was a ballot question voted on.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why we started in December and did so much in December and January. You know, that was meant to be that. So, you know, town staff knows that they have the calendar date circled that it's attendance plan, so you should get good attendance as far as that goes. And obviously any questions you get in advance, we're happy to get them. There's nothing wrong with that.
I think we do need to think about how to get enough information out to people that they know the meeting is taking place, that they can send questions in advance, that they can attend, all those things.
Yeah, if you have a non-town or school website presence or resource you can use to put out information, gather facts, gather questions, that'd be ideal.
So we need
non-town.
We'll need to have someone take notes who can't be a town employee, for
they
open
be,
meeting.
They
law.
Can't be paid.
Yeah, okay.
Well, they can volunteer. Technically.
Looking at you, John. You know, the one area that Ray did sort of kind of loosen his collar a little was electronic, because, you know, the laws really aren't designed for electronic communication. So you could probably get away with it. We could probably post this as a meeting. I'll check. we'd probably post as a meeting on the website, but I certainly don't think we can gather information and questions.
Yeah.
Just so you know. I mean, it's a FinCom meeting. I don't know why we couldn't post, you know, that the Board of Selectmen School Committee.
Well, you have to, right?
Meeting. Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't think so.
No.
So
So I think all the boards have said that they can attend, although we should talk specifically to library boards if they want to come.
Okay.
And you know, conceivably RMLD if they want to.
Okay.
And then I think we want to really see if we can get questions coming in. People I've spoken with have said it'd be great to get early questions.
Yeah.
And would yes for Reading be the best place to go for that, or is that
I think they could certainly help.
Yeah, or is that
and they could advertise what's called a meeting taking place on that date with the location and that.
Yeah.
The
way it should be.
And if we decide we want to try this on the spot technology or not, we can talk about that. If you want to try this,
the one that Bernie uses,
that's the one Bernie uses.
Okay.
Yeah, Lorraine pushed it out. Use this. Anyway, it's just it's a live technology that just if people are watching, they can submit questions and it comes into the organizer of the meeting.
Interesting.
Do you know if there's a charge for that?
So if you just use it for the basic for one event, it's free.
This free ones.
Yeah.
That one is for up to 1,000 people. So I think we'd be all right.
Let's hope so.
How do you access it through, like, the website or a website?
Download an app.
An app.
Yeah. Yeah, actually, you don't have to download the app for this one. It's actually very easy. Just go to it.
Okay.
Yeah. And what we do is we just make an event that has to be one person who organizes it.
Okay.
And then that creates an event number or name or something, and then that's what you go to.
Interesting. Let us know.
Yeah. Well, I think the discussion we had was that it would be great to have that resource with people able to ask questions of whomever at that point. It's just before the override, so that's kind of the last chance. So.
You're the most optimistic person I have met today.
Obviously, you know, as soon as you can get us questions, the better. I mean, I dare say most of the questions we'll have heard, but you never know. Mm-hmm. Some of them take some research, certainly. Mm-hmm.
I don't remember who I was talking to the other day, but it was a very surprising discussion where this particular person wasn't aware that public safety was part of the override.
Okay.
And that's when I kind of stepped back and said, you know, there'll be people at all different levels.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Starting at zero. Because
yeah.
I was thrown by that one.
Yeah, we've had different people come to our counter or ask questions, and the same idea, the range is big. And, you know, just not used to being interested in town government, which I totally understand. we have a small override section on the website. It's growing. We don't want to overdo it. I think last year we had so much, or 2 years ago, we had so much stuff there, it was too much. The one thing we don't have yet, which I don't know if we want, is our assessor produced an Excel spreadsheet of every single property and what the override would be. You do that again. I think honestly that the formula that's on the website is easy.
Mm-hmm.
You know your assessed value.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the only thing that was popular last time that we're not planning on this time, at least not yet. There's the one pager in progress that was the most popular thing last year by far. That should be up in a day or two. I just saw a draft today.
Does that look at the typical tax bill?
Yeah.
And break it?
Well, it actually has ranges of houses assessed value, like, I don't know, 400, 500, 600,
mm-hmm.
whatever.
Right.
It doesn't say average, because that doesn't
right.
mean
right.
a lot.
Does
right.
it break the tax bill into the components?
No, just the total.
Yeah. So that I thought was a very useful exhibit.
Okay.
Wait, what do you mean?
How
so
much
it takes an average. It says for a home assessed at $550,000, here's the tax bill. It's $8,000, whatever the number is. And then it breaks that $8,000 into kind of what are the assessments that led to that? You know, what's specific, coming from? The ones I remember in particular are, for example, the debt exclusions.
Oh, yeah.
So
I
you
know
can see specifically the high school and then a comment.
agreement that the high school comes off in
2024.
And then the library. And the library comes off in such and such.
Hereafter.
Yeah. Right. And then, you know, kind of here are the pieces. And I thought that one was very helpful. It also helps explain the difference between an exclusion, which is temporary, mm-hmm. and an override, which is forever.
Okay. Yeah, we put that up there. Yeah.
Yeah, I like that one very much. So is do we need to get Ray's opinion on RCTV?
I'll ask him if there's a problem. I'll let these two know. Like, the only reason there might be a problem is because technically their money flows through the town manager's office. We are paid. We pay them. They only fly in UMN I could possibly see. But they are legally separate, so I don't think it's a problem. It's
you
not taxpayer money.
Right, they're all different shows.
Yeah, you have no control over their budget.
Not at all.
Yeah.
Right, and you're also creating a live show, which I think might outweigh
those
issue,
little
it's best
to
technicalities,
ask.
You know, where to access, immediate access to information.
Yeah.
That will not be there.
You could call in remotely. Mark could work on it.
Think about Slido.
I'll leave it to Mark for the connection.
Yeah, that's right. I'm real good at it.
And I assume you're going to need a meet in April. Do you definitively agree on a date?
April 7th?
I marked them, so we should definitely make sure it's posted.
April 5th.
Yeah, I think so. Okay.
April 4th is actually a Wednesday. Right?
That's the day after the election.
Yeah.
I think it was April.
So I don't have it in here.
I don't think you picked the date.
I put it on the 11th.
About it. Okay.
I know.
Yeah, it is on the 11th. Okay. And I want to ask your advice. You know how that we have the spending scorecard in the budget? You know, all the lines. We've produced one if an override passes. Does that belong in the town meeting book? Or should we hand it out if one passes the night of town meeting? Yeah, it's a tough one. It's good information, but I don't want to send wrong messages.
Personally, I would lean towards handing it out the night of.
That's generally been our default, is don't assume anything. Provide information, but don't jump the gun. But this is something we have to know because it's going to the printer.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Right. Could publish it electronically if it passes right at that point.
We can even put it up on the website now.
Yeah, that makes sense.
But, okay, yeah. That's
right.
My leaning was not to do it, but I did have mixed feelings. I wanted to ask. Okay, that's all I have.
Other items of business before we discuss the minutes? Sure. You're all welcome to hang around for the minutes if you want.
Thank you.
Riveting.
4 a.m.
It's just that.
I just saw that. I looked out before you.
School's canceled.
John, don't give her the codes.
That's too funny.
It's not going to cause much.
That is great.
I would tell you, I have five names.
Is it not that?
Yeah. Bitch.
I know. We're waiting for it to be long.
It'll be too heavy.
How long is it going to
take? It's going to snow.
Yeah.
Is it right. Snowing at all?
Right.
I'll make a motion to accept the minutes of February 7th.
I have a second?
Second.
Okay. Any comments? I already had my one comment shot down, so.
Looks like I missed a good meeting.
They're all okay.
I'm just kidding.
That's right, they're all good.
No, I didn't miss that.
Oh, you did?
All right.
Right. So no comments on the minutes of the 7th. All right. All those in favor? So we only have 5 of us that were in attendance. Is that how it works?
2, 3, 4.
So we have 2 abstentions.
Vote for it in good faith.
I don't think it matters.
You can still vote for it. It's
not for many years.
Yeah. Lucky we still have quorum though. So.
Yeah, the minutes fail.
Is that written in somewhere?
Yeah. Do we need to modify that on the attendees?
I think so.
By present by phone until
until the matter is kicked down.
Time to get cut off.
Who shall we meet nameless to protect the
ceremoniously?
Approximately 8:05.
That's right.
Although, isn't this the one where you were cut off?
I know, correct.
This one he wasn't cut off.
Correct.
This one you
were. Oh, that's right.
Yeah.
This
made it
you
yeah.
Present.
I was there.
Yeah.
Yes.
This is the one with all the black underlines.
Yeah, fun.
Yeah.
Fun. 20-something roll call.
Oh, yeah, it's the one before you got cut off.
Which is not here. It's the...
I'm not here.
Yeah, that's right. Are we missing a set?
I think we
already voted.
Oh, we voted the ones in the middle?
Yeah. All right. Okay.
Yeah, you're right. I do remember that.
I
can tell you do too.
I know. Wow.
Okay.
I'll make another motion to accept the minutes of February 15th.
Second.
Okay. Any questions, comments, edits? Anything to be said? If not, we'll go for another vote on those minutes. All those in favor? And there is 7-0 on that one. So.
Mark just asked me a question just to make sure we're clear. We've talked about the 28th being a 7:30 meeting, correct?
Yes.
Okay.
That's good.
So it'll be posted on the website.
Yeah, I'll let you know Ray's opinion next week.
Okay. Okay. And then it is going to be our responsibilities to deal with Yes for Reading and get them to.
Yeah, and you're also going to need to talk to RCTV about, I don't know how popular the event will be, but there's really no parking there. So,
shuttle bus?
In the winter, you never know, it's late March, but, you know, there's across the street, but there's not a lot of parking. So, mm-hmm. You're going to have to think about that. I'll talk to the chief, see if he's got any concerns.
Can we find out if there's anything happening at the senior center?
Yeah, find out.
Let's see if we can use all the municipal lots.
Yep, that's a good question.
Else?
Motion to adjourn?
Second.
Okay. All those in favor? Unanimous again.